You ever find yourself in the situation where you think you're starting to understand something in math, and then all of a sudden, you learn that there's a co-thing? Maybe you're in linear algebra, and you're getting comfortable with vectors as fixed-length lists of numbers, and then suddenly, you come across covectors. Or maybe you're in an actual algebra class, and discover that coalgebras lurk in the shadows. Maybe you watched my video on monads, and later became one of the 30% of people who found my video on comonads. In all of these cases, the co-prefix alludes to a kind of duality. A lot of the time, these co-concepts arise by reversing arrows. For example, an algebra is an object with a multiplication map and a unit satisfying some axioms that can be drawn diagrammatically. Accordingly, a co-algebra is an object with a co-multiplication map and a co-unit satisfying dual axioms. What this means for mathematicians is that we get a two-for-one deal for each definition we come up with. So anyway, a set is an arbitrary container of things, called elements. If you don't want to get into trouble with the model theorists, just make sure your sets don't get too big. But otherwise, that's all there really is to sets. A coset, as the name implies, is an equivalence class of a group element under the action of a fixed subgroup. I'm sure you're disappointed. A coset doesn't really seem like the opposite of a set. If you're disappointed that the infallible field of mathematics has such annoying inconsistencies in terminology, I've got some bad news for you. As an act of defiance, and since I won't be talking about quotients of groups by subgroups anymore, let's redefine cosets to be the actual opposites to sets. Well, okay. What is the opposite of a set? Taking after algebras, a coset object in some category should be a set object in the opposite category. However, all objects of a category are set objects, in a sense. This leads us to the conclusion that a coset object should just be an object of any opposite category. Okay, so I've said a lot about opposite categories. Let's just make sure we're on the same page. Category theory provides a very general framework to study entire classes of objects of a certain type, and it does so by reducing individual objects to mere points and reducing the structure-preserving maps between them into arrows. In other words, we can think of a category as a directed graph with a rule for composing edges. Some people, like analysts, would argue that categories are too reductive, as all the information of the object suddenly disappears into these zero-dimensional labeled vertices. They've clearly never heard of the Unet dilemma. Anyway, once you overcome the conceptual obstacles necessary to accept the categorical perspective, one tool you gain is the concept of duality. Since categories reduce objects and functions to points and arrows with a composition rule, we can reverse all the arrows in a category and obtain a completely new category with entirely dual properties to the original. By performing these abstract gymnastic techniques on the large category of sets, we obtain the mysterious category of cosets, wherein a map from y to x is a function from x to y of the underlying sets. But gee, I hear you say. Doesn't this mean that our new cosets are just sets? We've only changed the direction of the maps between them, and the objects are the same as before. While it would certainly seem that way, we need to remember that the objects of a category are really just points. The implied structure and form of these objects are determined by the maps between them. Since this isn't satisfying enough on its own, our strategy now is to try to view a set theoretic function from x to y as some sort of function from y to x. By doing this, we should get a better understanding of what the opposite of a set ought to be. Let's start with the wrong idea and try to correct it until we get something that works. If we have a function g from y to x of sets, this means that g associates to every element y a unique element x. If we want to somehow view g as a function in the opposite direction, then a natural first guess is to send an element x to the element y where g of y is equal to x. Of course, this only really works in defining a function if g is invertible. If, for example, we take y to be the set of real numbers and take x to be the set of positive real numbers, and then take g to be the function sending y to y squared plus 1, then we can see the two main problems with this approach. Consider the point x equals 1. There are multiple candidates we could choose for y. We could take y equals 1 or y equals minus 1, and g sends both to x equals 1. On the other hand, the point x equals a half is outside the image of g, meaning that there do not exist any y that map to x in this situation. To remedy these, we could instead send an element x to the set of all y that g maps to x. This is called the preimage of x under g. This is a perfectly well-defined function. However, the issue now is that the preimage of g doesn't map x to y. Rather, it maps x to the set of subsets of y, also known as the power set of y. But why is this really a problem? Well, suppose we have two functions g from y to x and h from z to y. By composing these two functions, we can define a function from z to x. If we reverse g and h this way, how can we combine these reversals to compute the reversal of g composed with h? This cannot be done in a very straightforward way, and the problem is because these reversed arrows cannot be composed. Probably the easiest way to fix this is to change the domain of the preimage function to be the power set as well. Then, everything can compose together the way we expect to. To extend the preimage function from x to the power set of x is simple. Instead of sending an element x to the set of all y where g of y equals x, we just send a subset of x to the set of all y where g of y is in that subset. With this, taking power sets reverses functions in a way that also reverses the function's compositions. This property of reversing the order of composition could be called contravariant functoriality, meaning that we have defined a functor from one category to the opposite of another. In our specific case, we have shown how to realize the construction of power sets as a functor from cosets to sets. So G, I hear you say, are you suggesting that the opposite of a set is its power set? Well, in a way, sure, but it's not that simple. To get a complete picture, we would have to also be able to describe how to go back from power sets to cosets. You might have noticed that, in some bold and brash way, every power set contains its original set. The elements of the original set each define a unique one-element subset. While this is certainly true, it's not very helpful right now. Our goal right now is to understand what makes something a power set so that we can use that as an intrinsic description of a coset. The problem here is that we're not thinking categorically. We focus too much on the objects of the category when we should instead be thinking about the maps in between. Suppose we're given the power set of x and the power set of y, and I describe some function phi from the power set of x to the power set of y. How do you find a backwards pointing function g between the underlying sets such that phi is equal to the preimage of g? At this level of generality, the answer is simple. You just can't. A relatively straightforward combinatorics argument shows that preimage functions are actually quite rare among maps between power sets. Suppose, for instance, that x and y both have three elements each. Then, there are over 16 million maps from the power set of x to the power set of y, but only 27 of them are preimage functions. Trying to filter through all functions between power sets to identify which of them are preimage functions forces us to look more closely at the structure of power sets, so that we can understand how these structures are preserved by preimage functions. By figuring out which functions are preimage functions, we invariably bring ourselves that much closer to understanding what a coset should be. So, what structure on power sets should we focus on? Well, there's two big candidates: partial ordering by inclusions, or set operations. Fortunately for us, both structures imply each other in this case, since power sets are very nice. Therefore, let's just focus on the set operations. Of particular interest to us right now are unions and intersections. The set-theoretic union corresponds to the logical operation of disjunction. An element is contained in the union of two subsets A and B if it is contained in A or it is contained in B. In a power set, we can take the union of as many subsets as we want. Moreover, the preimage of the union of a family of sets is exactly the union of the preimages of these sets. On the other hand, the set-theoretic intersection corresponds to the logical operation of conjunction. An element is contained in the intersection of two subsets A and B if it is contained in A and it is contained in B. In a power set, we can also take the intersection of as many subsets as we want. Moreover, the preimage of the intersection of a family of sets is exactly the intersection of the preimages of these sets. Now we know that preimage functions preserve arbitrary unions and intersections. Is that enough to characterize them? Yes. Given a function phi from the power set of x to the power set of y that preserves unions and intersections, we can show that phi must be the preimage of some function g from y to x. How can we reconstruct g from phi? That is, given an element y, how do we use phi to determine g of y? Well, g of y is equal to x if and only if y is in the preimage of x under g. Therefore, we are led to the following reconstruction. Define g of y to be x, where x is the element chosen so that y is an element of phi applied to the singleton set containing x. This is a good prototype, but we have to make sure that this actually makes sense. In other words, we need to verify two things. First, for any element y, we have to show that we can always find some element x where y is in phi applied to the singleton set containing x. Secondly, if there are two elements x1 and x2 where y lies simultaneously in phi applied to the singleton containing x1 and phi applied to the singleton containing x2, then this is only possible if x1 equals x2. To verify the first condition, which ensures that we have at least one choice for g of y, we will first use the fact that phi must preserve intersections. Specifically, phi must preserve the empty intersection. What is the empty intersection? Well, remember that the intersection of subsets of y consists of all elements of y that are contained in every subset in the intersection. If there are no subsets in this intersection, then this intersection should just consist of all elements of y, with no constraints. In exactly the same way, the empty intersection in x is the entirety of x. So, since phi is supposed to preserve arbitrary intersections, it must also preserve the empty intersections, which means that phi applied to the entire set x must be the entire set y. To see what this buys us, we have to use the fact that phi also preserves unions. We can write x as the union of its singleton element subsets, and this union must be preserved by phi. Combined with the preservation of empty intersections, this means that every element of y must lie in the union of phi applied to every singleton subset of x. This is exactly what the first statement says. As for the second condition, we basically dualize our argument. First, note that an empty union always yields the empty set. It's impossible for any element to be contained in at least one set of the union if there are no sets in the union at all. Therefore, phi must send the empty set in x to the empty set of y. In particular, since the intersection of distinct singleton subsets of x is empty, and phi preserves intersections, it is impossible for any element of y to lie simultaneously in the image under phi of two distinct singleton subsets of x. This completes the proof. So far, we've managed to prove that preimage functions correspond to maps between power sets that preserve arbitrary unions and intersections. This means that unions and intersections are a critical part of how a power set is the opposite of a set. We can therefore try to describe a coset intrinsically as equipped with a join and meet operation corresponding to the union and intersection of the power set, respectively. Working through it carefully, you'll realize that the join and the meet operations will define... If you were about to say a complete Boolean algebra, then you just assume the law of the excluded middle. Hell no. Even if we do exclude the middle, the structure of a complete Boolean algebra is still not enough to completely characterize power sets. To construct a counterexample, it'll take a little bit of work, so bear with me. Let's say that two sets of natural numbers are essentially the same if they differ by only finitely many elements. For example, the set of odd prime numbers and the set of prime numbers that don't end in a 5 are essentially the same, because the only differences are that the first set contains 5 and the second set contains 2, and these are the only two differences. On the other hand, the set of prime numbers and the set of odd numbers are not essentially the same, because the set of prime numbers contains 2 and the set of odd numbers contains every odd multiple of 9, for example, and that's already infinitely many differences. Now that we have this relationship between subsets of natural numbers, define A to be the set of all subsets of natural numbers, except that we say that two sets of natural numbers are equal in A if they are essentially the same. You can check that the unions and intersections of sets in this case descend to well-defined join and meet operations on A. Moreover, these operations define a complete Boolean algebra structure on A. So, we have a complete Boolean algebra. However, A is not isomorphic to the power set of anything. We can prove this by trying to infer what the singletons in A would have to be. In a Boolean algebra, the smallest element corresponds to the empty set. Singletons, on the other hand, are the second smallest elements. Since every finite set is essentially the same as the empty set, they all correspond to the same element in A. This means that any second smallest element of A would have to correspond to an infinite subset of N. The problem with this is that every infinite subset of N is strictly larger than another infinite subset of N. What you do is you take an infinite set, sort its elements in increasing order, and remove every second element. The remaining set still has infinitely many elements, but it's also not essentially the same as the original. Since the resulting subset is also infinite, we can repeat this process indefinitely. In other words, A doesn't have any singletons. But this is only possible if A is the power set of the empty set. But this is also false. The power set of the empty set has one element, but the same argument as above shows that A has infinitely many distinct elements. This therefore proves that A cannot be isomorphic to the power set of anything. This counterexample also shows that singleton sets are very important in a power set. This is the final missing piece for cosets. In the literature, these singletons are called atoms, defined to be minimal non-bottom elements. A Boolean algebra is said to be atomic if every element can be realized as a join of atoms. This corresponds to the fact that, in a power set algebra, every subset can be realized as a union of singletons. With this final piece, our contravariant power set functor induces an equivalence between the opposite of the category of sets and the category of complete atomic Boolean algebras. This finally leads us to a more satisfying definition of a coset. A coset is just a complete atomic Boolean algebra. If you're still here, thank you for watching. If you liked what you watched, then there is a set of ways that you could express that. If you didn't like what you watched, it's fine. In the lattice of subsets of people, the set of people who've got my back will always contain a certain atom.